say you love sexy cinema and action movies, but don't want to appear completely lowbrow. All you have to do is learn everything you can about Rome. From neorealist classics by De Sica and Rossellini to gladiator flicks starring Charlton Heston and Russell Crowe, Rome is the film site that keeps crowds clapping. In the next half hour, senior editors Ondine Cohane and Mark Connolly buzz through the fashion, nightlife, food, and history of Rome, film's perpetually happening location.
Ondine really wanted me to see Rome to its fullest, to its best. And she came up with a really great idea of retracing the steps from the characters from Roman Holiday, Audrey Hepburn and Gregory Peck.
Roman Holiday is one of the most amazing films ever done in Rome. And I think not only in the plot of the movie, this princess who leaves her palace, gets away from her claustrophobic entourage, and runs around town, meets this glamorous newspaper man, but also what they do during the day is so charming. They hit the history, but they do the things that everyday Romans do. Rome is an incredible setting for films, and this is the setting for Roman Holiday. We're on Via Margutta, and this is where Audrey Hepburn and Gregory Peck started their day, right on the street in this building complex.
Oh, that was his apartment. This is where his apartment
exactly.
was?
Exactly.
So I was really excited to visit Via Margutta 51, because in the movie that was where Audrey Hepburn slept over at Gregory Peck's apartment.
So, Ondine, Via Margutta, or 51 Via Margutta, isn't just well-known for Roman Holiday, now, is it?
No, Federico Fellini actually lived on this street
really?
As well. Rome is a city that demands to have movies made in it. And everywhere that you turn, it's like another movie set. You can imagine Audrey Hepburn on the Spanish Steps. And I think by watching Roman Holiday and then coming to Rome, it inspires you to do the same things that they did.
So we're going to have a real Roman Holiday day.
We're going to have a real Roman Holiday, and this is where the Roman Holiday started, on the Spanish Steps, which has been really a tourist destination since the 18th century.
And it still is.
Everyone congregates here. It's such a landmark of Rome and very, very cinematic. The talented Mr. Ripley was also filmed down in the Piazza di Spagna.
It was getting pretty hot walking around the city, and it was time for an ice cream break, or a gelato break, as they say in Italy. And like in the movie, Gregory takes Audrey to get her first Roman ice cream.
Theoretically, I should have had my ice cream today at the Spanish Steps, but I felt that the ice cream at the gelati shop near the Pantheon was better.
What do you think, fruit or chocolate?
I'm going for the hardcore. I think I want chocolate and banana in a cup.
Look at that bad
pink or purple?
Pink.
Grazie. I think one of the most exciting things about being in Rome is going from a small little alleyway or a narrow twisting street and then coming across these amazing piazzas and architectural structures. And then at the same time that you're looking at these things, you can have a drink and be in the most spectacular jaw-dropping environment.
To Rome.
To champagne in the afternoon.
You know, one of the most interesting things for me about the whole premise of Roman Holiday is the fact that you get to enjoy the simple pleasures in life. And here we are, champagne in the afternoon, a beautiful little piazza, and what's right behind us.
It's incredible. And the Pantheon is just one of the most incredible structures in Rome. It was built as a temple for the pagan gods, and then later on they turned it into a church when Rome became Christian. When I decided to take Mark on a Roman holiday, part of it was loving the sights that Gregory Peck took Audrey to on her day, but it was also about my secret fantasy about riding around Rome on a Vespa.
Have a look at the light.
It's beautiful. I've got to focus on the road now. You know, drivers do that, sweetie. I have to say that riding up the long dual carriageway up to the Colosseum was pretty special. It's so majestic, and it just immediately makes one reference every major sort of historical epic that you've ever seen in any movie. So the Colosseum, built in what, AD 72?
AD 72.
And has been the scene of many, many,
many
movies.
Absolutely. Ben-Hur, uh-huh. Spartacus, Cleopatra, Quo Vadis, Julius Caesar, one of my favorites, Marlon Brando, and of course, Roman Holiday.
Oh, of course. Hello.
So Ondine really had the Vespa bug, and she really wanted to drive me around the city, so I gallantly agreed and got on the back, and although we were retracing Roman Holiday, it kind of felt like something out of a Fellini movie. We were zigzagging all over the Piazza del Popolo. She was having fun, I was holding on for dear life.
I don't think Mark was feeling particularly safe when I was driving around Piazza del Popolo, but I was in control.
Arriving at the Campidoglio, I have to say I was a little relieved because the traffic had gotten really heavy, and I was really full of the sense of kind of modern Rome, busy, buzzy Rome. And then once I parked the Vespa, walked up the stairs, and walked through the splendor of the Renaissance Square, New Rome melted away for me, and I was presented by Renaissance Rome.
So these buildings are really, really beautiful. What's the history behind them?
Well, they were designed by Michelangelo, but he actually died before they were completed, but his designs were so great that they were able to replicate them pretty much perfectly. I love the juxtaposition of coming through modern Rome into the Renaissance, and then we'll go out into the ancient. You go through the square and down this almost medieval little alleyway, and then there in front of you is the Forum with the Colosseum in back of you, and that is one of the most awe-inspiring views, I think, in the world.
This is a site of ancient Rome.
Seeing Rome through the lens of Roman Holiday really allows you to see many of Rome's major landmarks. And not only that, it really puts you into a Roman spirit. Well, there may not be a bench for you, Princess, but the view's pretty magnificent. Took me to the Campo di Fiori market, which was great for me to see because Rome is a city that marches on its stomach. I mean, this looks like it is the basis of Roman cuisine right here, doesn't it?
Absolutely. It's very simple, you know, whatever is in season.
This place feels really Roman to me. I mean, it reminds me of something out of De Sica's The Bicycle Thief.
Well, that was filmed at one of the most famous markets in Rome, Porto Portese, but that's an antiques market. This is the most famous Campo di Fiori for flowers and fruits and vegetables. Marketplaces are another part of Rome that are sort of everyday things, and yet, as a visitor, you go there and you feel just like this is such a spectacle, even though it's something that for most Romans they do every single day.
Look at these.
Oh, it looks amazing.
Buongiorno. Buongiorno, buongiorno signore.
Che c'è di stagione?
Per l'Italia sarebbe i paragonini del bosco.
These are like wild strawberries.
They are tiny, aren't they?
They're tiny, but so sweet. Grazie.
Prego.
Oh, wow.
Amazing.
Really incredible. It almost tastes like fake strawberry flavoring.
the different fruits in season, the vendors, the characters, all the time being enclosed by a beautiful space is really a wonderful way to see some of Roman life. I took Mark to San Pietrino because it exemplifies the kind of Roman cooking that I like so much. It's very simple. It's influenced by Jewish cuisine. And we met with the owner, Oscar, and his grandmother, Paola, who are the owners of this restaurant in the Jewish quarter of the city.
I thought we were just going to sit down and have a little bit of lunch, but oh no, they wanted us to go shopping for our lunch.
They took us to one of the local shops and showed us the typical Italian meat.
Sì, Marco, allora, dobbiamo comprare un po' di guanciale e del prosciutto.
Okay. And what is that?
I know, I said that I want to buy ham and pork jowl.
La nonna, this is the woman of the family. She is the one who is most respected. The way that her tomato sauce is made is the way that everyone else in the family should make it. And seeing Paola with her grandson, Oscar, you could see that the power dynamic was all in her favor.
The tomato should have been made this morning. She's not very happy.
She likes the pecorino. Grattato all'ultimo minuto, the last time.
Would you better work a bit harder?
She's going to be very angry if you're not ready.
Yes.
She rules this kitchen.
They prepared this dish that's veal and prosciutto that's called salta in bocca.
Salta in bocca.
That means to jump into your mouth. That's how good it is. It jumps into your mouth.
What a great name. It's an exquisite dish, and it's a very simple dish. It's really good quality veal that she, Paola, wrapped around the ham and then put in the pan with oil and butter and quite a few sage leaves.
It only takes 10 minutes to cook,
wow.
And then it jumps into your mouth.
My cook is already.
Well, I'll just wait.
Is it possible?
It's really, really delicious.
They prepared pasta alla amatriana, which is pig jowl, tomatoes, a little bit of onion.
Non ci divaghiamo.
She's telling him to watch her pasta. She doesn't want it overcooked. She wants everything to be perfect.
Cooked for about 20 minutes and poured over rigatoni, and then you add a little pecorino cheese. It was superb. Ask her if she'll come home with us.
Vieni a New York con noi.
For many, Italian film is synonymous with Cinecittà, the sprawling film studio on the outskirts of Rome. Many of the 1960s and 70s most famous films were shot there. However, it wasn't always such a symbol of artistic freedom. In the 1940s, when it opened, it was dedicated by none other than Benito Mussolini. For Condé Nast Traveler, I'm Dana Dickey.